It's good to be back. I have flyers up here, but you have to come up here to get them. So this is where the Catholic thing checks in. If not, if people can do a corporal work of mercy and pass things back to the people who need a flyer with the saints that we'll be talking about today. A few months ago, Peter gave me a call. And he shared the vision of the exhibit, which is fantastic. And I never talk to my weak suit. I always talk to my strong suit. And so when he wanted something on Spaniards in California, I don't know, French Canadian, my mom was born in Nova Scotia. And then it was just kind of on the theme of evangelization or spreading the gospel. And I said, well, you know, the 19th century is really very full between, in terms of Mother Cabrini and Mother Seton, and of course, in terms of Kateri Tekakwitha and obviously Isaac Jogues. So given the fact that it is a holy year and given the fact that St. Patrick was recently renoed over the last 2 years or so if you get a chance to get down to Manhattan, I have not yet. But anyway, I said, well, what about this? How about the cathedral doors? Because as you see, depicted on the cathedral doors are the saints of the diocese. And it's very projecting as far as the Catholics within America. So obviously we have Christ the King, and then we have St. Joseph and St. Patrick, representing for all practical purposes the ethnicity of Catholicism in New York City since its almost establishment. And then finally we have Kateri, Mother Seton, no particular chronological order, Isaac Jogues, and Mother Cabrini. And it's interesting because when I thought of how I was going to present this, I just didn't want to be kind of up here pedantic, but just kind of use a little bit of a creativity, a little of imagination. And so one of my favorite quotes, anytime I teach, I always put on the board, have I considered? For all of my courses, history, communications, whatever. And this is a quote that I like very much, which really defines these individuals, and it is this: our lives are shaped by those who love us and those who refuse to love us. Okay, so Don Corleone kind of had a grasp on this when he said, an Italian Catholic, technically, okay, he always said, I keep my friends close, but my enemies closer. Okay, so it's like, here's looking at you, kid, from Casablanca. So again, all of these people were framed in one way or the other according to this very simple statement. Now, the next one is, have you considered Jesus? Well, I certainly hope we have, all right? They sure did. But the spreading of the gospel can be very gentle and very, very specific. And this goes back to Sister Mary Aloysius. Yes, that was her name. And she was a Mercy Sister, my first grade teacher at Our Lady of Victory Academy. That is now Mercy College in Dobbs Ferry. And we were about to make our first communion, and it has stuck. And so she wrote the name Jesus on the board. And of course, we're like five or whatever. And she said, boys and girls, Jesus loved us so much that he put us in his name. And so we're about in us. We really are. It's not just me, it's us. God loves us personally, but he takes us to heaven communally, as the church teaches us. However, when we do step into eternity, we step there alone to meet him. And with that, since we're talking about, all right, have I considered the mix that will await me in heaven? For example, just kind of touching on saints that I've found interesting, Jerome, the biblical of the Vulgate translator, was so pugnacious that you had to kind of test the room before you went in, and it was something that he would, you know, you'd have to prep. So you can imagine him being in glory with someone as gentle as the little flower. What will they say to each other? Okay? Well, it's not so much that as opposed to the next observation when we talk about eternity, and it is this. Have I considered that when we love someone, it's not so much looking at each other, but looking in the same direction? So we share a journey with each other, and then finally that journey will be glorious for us. All right, the beautiful liturgy as far as our baptism. The one thing when I go to a baptism, when they pass the candle to the child or to the godparent, and they say, and keep it bright, and when you go out to meet him, we're all on our way whether we like it or not. Now, how we weigh along is our business. And that's what all of these four people were concerned about. They were concerned about their way and how they were doing on their way. Okay? And we have to talk about this because we're talking about saints. It's very nice to kind of put saints on a bronze door where they witness Fifth Avenue and all the commerce every day. But I can assure you that if you touch these today, they're cold. None of these men and women were in real life. They had a life and they were very different and they were very, very warm. Years ago, I heard a quote. I was in counseling for a period of time. And my counselor said to me, do you know what a saint is? And he was a minister. And I said, well, what are you getting at, Chuck? And he said, well, let me tell you a story. And he said, they took a child into a cathedral. And they walked the child around, looking at all of the beautiful stained glass windows, such as Chartres or even Patrick's itself or wherever, the great Gothics. And during the Middle Ages, they called it the poor man's Bible. And so it took about maybe an hour to go through the cathedral, and they brought the child back out. And he said to me, he said, you know what they asked the child? They asked the child, what is a saint? And the child just looked up and he said, a saint is someone that lets the light shine through. And Jesus spoke of himself as the light of the world. We are given that light to dwell within us. And what we do with that light to a greater or lesser degree determines our ability to comprehend God. These were not mystical people. So there's no Avila here. There's no mysticism. No Catherine of Siena. All right? These are very pragmatic American people, for the lack of a better. Not that they didn't have their moments, and I'll get into that in a little bit. All right? But, for example, yesterday's reading, the first reading was from the Acts of the Apostles, the conversion of Paul. And I recently shared this with a dear friend whose spouse has stepped into eternity recently, and we were talking. And I said to this person, I said, you know, I said, the way I think of heaven is this in terms of preparing. You look at the stoning of Saint Stephen. And it says, and he looked up and he saw the Son of Man in glory. And he was actually able to say that in front of the crowd. And then you compare that to Saint Paul, probably the greatest evangelist on the face of the earth at that time. But at the moment of his conversion, at the sight of the Lord, he was blinded because he couldn't take the light. Stephen could. So that kind of gives us an idea of what heaven must be like. And saints have prepared themselves to have that light adjustment as far as they are ready to go, as the buzz phrase of the last 25 years, they are ready to go to the light. And the reason why they're ready to go to the light is because they never lived without the light. When my kids would ask me in terms of, you know, and you have to talk about the communion of saints. When they would ask me about purgatory in terms of what's that, I said, well, it is a mystery as far as eternity. But I said, for me, and again, I would always go back to my own point of reference, even today. I said, do you ever go to the movies in the summertime? And I said, at the Poughkeepsie Galleria, when you go out the door, you go directly into the parking lot. And I said, most of the time, I'm like this. All right? I said, to me, that's purgatory, meaning something in my life has not been able to see God clearly. And so there has to be an adjustment. I said, the other thing you have to keep in mind is when you die, your spirit, and our spirit always wants to do the right thing. It's the body who fights us. Oh, I don't want to do this, because we're spirit, soul, and body. And so what happens when you deal with men and women that we call saints, as I said, they've adjusted to the light here, and they are ready to go. And probably there is no waiting period, for the lack of a better term. And they are so in the light that they can bring us into the light also, and we call that intercession. So Paul says, we are surrounded by a cloud of witness. And so I always, since I was a boy, have prayed to my Aunt Stella. That's my mother's oldest sister. Because I was adopted, and she would always write on the books and the cards that she would say, to my little darling. because I was adopted, and she wanted me to feel part of this family. And she died, unfortunately, very young, and she was very devoted to my grandparents and my large family of 10, and she was always the gold standard in terms of the family of someone who lived a very spiritual but very pragmatic and practical life. And so when we talk about this, and we talk about looking in the same direction, when we are in heaven, that's what we will be doing. We won't be looking at each other. We'll be looking, as the church teaches, at the beatific vision, something that we can't even get our minds around. Heaven is something that we struggle with, because all of us, at one time or another, are tempted, and all of us fell short of the glory of God, as Paul says, all right? But it's also a situation of delayed satisfaction. So if you can really psychologically look at that, now that delayed satisfaction, hopefully, will last for 95 years. All right? So it's that cookie or that social experiment they do with the young child. Now, if you don't touch that cookie for the next 5 minutes, I'll give you two. I'm going to be back in 10. Just watch the clock. And so the kid's like this. That's us. The delayed satisfaction is like, oh, I'm going to be 80 years old, but I'm 35 now. Come on, let's blah, 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 blah. All right? So these people never lost their focus. Never argued about the delayed reaction. Struggled with it, but believed firmly that what awaits me there is greater than what I desire here. So what I'd like to do is just introduce you in kind of chronological order of mission. Isaac Jogues, Kateri Tekakwitha, Mother Seton, and Francis Cabrini. And what I'd like to do when I talk to Peter, I'd like to create a conversation. If you are a history buff like I am, about in the late 70s and early 80s, Steve Allen produced for PBS a history series called Meeting of the Minds. And his wife, Jane Meadows, would always play a woman out of history. And then he would invite two other notable actors to come, and they too would portray this very eclectic gathering. So you might have Machiavellian sitting with St. Francis or Christopher Columbus or whatever. And of course, she was born to do it, Elizabeth I. I mean, come on, red hair and jewelry, that's Jane anyway. And they would have this conversation. So when Peter proposed me doing this presentation, I said it'd be very interesting to imagine these four very different people sitting down and talking about how they looked in the same direction, having very little in common. And the interesting thing, if they all sat down, the first thing that would probably surprise Isaac Jogues is Mother Seton would welcome him in French, because she was very well born. Her father, Richard Bailey, was actually born in Fairfield, Connecticut. He will go on to move in very high social circles. He actually is the first health department director of New York City. So she and her sister live a very, very privileged life. And she moves in the circles, for example, in 1789, when George Washington is sworn in. You could probably connect the dots and believe that her father and her family probably stood by Federal Hall, which is where the Stock Exchange now, and witnessed on April 30th, 1879, the swearing in of George Washington as president. Because what many people don't realize, the first capital for many years was New York City. Later in some documents, I also found that because he was health director, he was in communication with Alexander Hamilton, because he, Richard Bailey, was very interested in studying disease. And the one disease, believe it or not, that plagued New York City at that time was yellow fever. He dies of that disease several years later. So the first thing that would be taken back as they sat down is she would greet him in French, and then he, to make Kateri feel comfortable, would greet her in Mohawk, because he did learn that language. The other thing that would probably take place is, because of his personality, he would probably keep his hands under the table or close to his lap. And the reason why he does that is part of the torture that he was subject to in the Mohawk Valley area prior to his death, is they literally bit off his thumbs. So he could not celebrate Mass legally. The torture that I researched, I won't even bring up here. The only thing that I will say in one word that even comes close to it is ISIS, believe it or not. I mean, just horrific brandings and coals and stabbings and slashings, all right? And he was very much out of his league. And by that I mean he enters the Jesuits at roughly 18 years of age, a man of letters. He was also the son of middle-class people. And so he too was very, very well educated. And another factor is this, in terms of considering all four of them. And it's a very simple phrase, but it does have a lot of meaning, and it's this. The will of God will not lead you where His love cannot keep you. If you see the exhibit downstairs, there's the volumes of what were known as the Jesuit resolutions, and they were very well circulated in Europe at the time. And that was basically the feedback from the New World concerning the mission activity in the New World. And everybody caught the spirit of that, and Isaac Jogues did too. So he teaches literature for about 10 years in France, trains to be a priest, and then he comes to the shores in roughly 1834, and he's here for a long period of time, and things are kind of like moving along. But just to give you an idea of just the adventure, now you know where Albany is, and so that's where the missions are, all right, so there. He travels all the way out to where the Upper Peninsula of Michigan meets the Mid, all right, Sainte-Marie or Sault Ste. Marie. So there's actually a quote from a Presbyterian or a Congregationalist in terms of, you know, praising him. He said, "I barely got outside of Boston to preach to the Native American peoples. Here's this man, all right, halfway across the then continental North American continent." And so that's the other thing, is all of these people, these four individuals, were taken out of their element. And there is that factor called risk. One of the things that I do with my students is I teach a communications course, and I say, Vanna White, all right, it's kind of like Hangman. And so I say this, when somebody wins the Academy Award, and when somebody takes home the Tony or the Heisman Trophy or whatever, all right, this is really what they're rewarding. And they go around and we do this, and they'll call out a four-letter word. And of course I start, because they're college kids, I say, not that four-letter word, all right? And so they'll guess. And it comes down to this. Risk. Meaning out of your comfort zone. You know, how many want to earn an Oscar, but how many have to do it through a take that's going to take 52 times? Or a Tony. Or get up to train for 6 hours before school so you get to stand on the platform and be awarded the Olympic gold. So what we really do is we honor risk. It's not the fact of what they did, it's the fact that we envy them in a very loving way, because we basically say, that is something I could not do. So all of these four people are going to take a risk. And the risk they are going to take is to move closer in their spiritual journey. So Isaac comes, unfortunately he's martyred, but the symbolism is not to be missed. And as I said in the flyer, I'm just kind of hitting the highlights, because we'll get into some other material. But just imagine this image for yourself. I live in New York, I've lived in New York, as the introduction said, all my life, and everything in New York to the east is a tributary of the Hudson River, including the Mohawk River, which is kind of west, which the canal gets connected to in the 18th century and goes all the way to the other day. Well, they murder him. He is tomahawked in the village. And then his co-missionary is martyred in tomahawk the next day. They cut off their heads. They throw the heads and the bodies into the Mohawk. And the blood of the martyrs begins to flow. And as you know, that famous saying, the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. So you can imagine, now the Hudson, because they're all going to live at some point in time in their lives, the Hudson plays to a certain degree for all four of these individuals. For example, Elizabeth Seton is born on Staten Island. and she will live there for her youth. And that is where the Hudson empties in, and she crosses the Hudson, New York Harbor all the time, going back and forth for her husband. They will live on Wall Street. We'll get to that in a second. The second one, of course, is Kateri, and she actually follows the Hudson because there comes a time in her life where there's an attack on her village, and for her safety, she moves to Canada, to a more stable Christian environment. And she's going to follow the Hudson River, the northern, more narrow, up into the Adirondacks. And then she will actually pass what is known as Lake George. And Lake George is actually named by Isaac Jogues the Lake of the Blessed Sacrament, before it's Lake George. Okay? Because they are Christianizing everything. You have the St. Lawrence River because it was discovered on the Feast of St. Lawrence, etc., etc. So there really is in the north, as far as Canada, a very Catholic presence, naming and all of that, because it's what the missionaries were doing. And so you have, you know, Kateri, and she is not going to convert until she's roughly 18. She's worked within the Jesuit community. All right. And the minute she does convert, her mother was Christian, but she never really looked in that direction. And so what's going to take place is she's going to work with the Jesuit ministers in terms of the priest. And then all of a sudden, she decides that this is what she wants for her life. And then about 2 years later, she is going to take on the Feast of the Annunciation in March, when she again is about 19. She only lives until she's 24. And her feast day, according to my research, she actually died tomorrow on April 17th, okay? And then according to my research, her feast day is technically April 18th, celebrating the first day in glory. And so she, interestingly enough, it would be very interesting to see what Mother Seton and Kateri would say to each other, because this, of all four, she was an extremely aesthetic person, almost to the point of my research and even perhaps you reading in terms of long hours of prayer, almost like the rope around the waist, the sense of just suffering, all right? She would actually put thorns in her bed. So again, this is kind of a spirituality that I don't know whether Elizabeth Ann Seton would fully understand. Clearly, she could not look at Kateri, but she could say, you know, sister to sister in the Lord, at least you and I are looking in the same direction, okay? Because heaven is going to be a mix in terms of their journey, and in terms of us understanding their journey. Because the bottom line, when everything is being said about our own personal spiritual life, the only two people that have to understand our spiritual life is ourselves and the Lord. Some people are very comfortable with a certain type of spirituality. Some people are very uncomfortable with a certain type of spirituality, all right? I prefer, for example, something a little bit more uproarious, for the lack of a better term, and played in a band, etc. But some people like a more monastic flavor. And I think when we look at the saints and we look at these four people, you have to kind of keep that in mind. So as I said, getting back to Mother Seton, Mother Seton is raised very, very wealthy. She marries a man that she is madly in love with. This is William Seton. His father is a very, very prosperous businessman. They own Seton Mercantile. That's where, for example, comes into play in her life. The expression, "I'm waiting for my ship to come in." If you were in the mercantile trade, you would not make the profit until the vessel arrived and your fortune could be sold and kind of, you know, turned into hard cash. Well, unfortunately, they are married. They have five children. And during the beginnings of what we understand as the Napoleonic War, because from an American history point of view, France and England were both vying for America, young America's attention. It's only going to be a matter of years until war breaks out with Great Britain itself. By the way, Mother Seton will die, according to the British, a British citizen, because she was born under the British Empire, as you see on her little bio. The British actually start the War of 1812 because they're impressing. So if you're born before the official United States of America, as far as the British are concerned, your country changed, but your citizenship didn't. Get on the boat. And so that really creates the War of 1812, what is known as the impressment of American citizen. So technically, by the book, she, till the day she dies, will be regarded as a British citizen in the eyes of the British government. But anyway, what happens is everything is lost. The fleet is lost, and they literally file bankruptcy. There's a document that says one Christmas Eve, early in the 1800s, she actually sits by the door because the creditors are waiting outside, and she's afraid they're going to break in and literally take what little she has left. But she still is deeply, deeply in love with William. Now, what happened is part of that import-export, he had hooked up his family for a number of years to what are known as the Felicis. So now we can introduce conversation to Mother Cabrini, Italiano, thank you very much. And so at the table, she would actually say, oh, your friends, you know, your countrymen were actually very good friends of my husband and myself. And then she would probably surprise everybody around at the table, even though that she was a foundress of a religious community. And she would reach down under her habit and she would pull out a gold locket, and in the gold locket till the day she died was a lock of hair from William. Because she's going to sail with William to the Felicis. They have invited her over. It is a warmer climate. He has advanced her tuberculosis. And they arrive, and unfortunately, because they did not know much about disease, the ship that arrives at Leghorn, which is roughly on the east coast of northern Italy, a ship arrived giving the terrible news that yellow fever was in New York City. The next boat in, with three Americans on it, is her boat, her husband, and her youngest daughter, Anna. And the three of them are quarantined in a prison that would rival the Bastille. They're not under guard as arrest, but they are there because of quarantine. And they have to stay there in the cold of December for 30 days. And it just said in her writing, she would actually lay on her husband just to comfort him. They tried to have some kind of a Christmas, and he will die on December 27th, 1803. And she would also say to Mother Cabrini, my William is buried in your homeland, because he is buried in the old English cemetery outside the Pisa of Leaning Tower fame. And so again, all of these threads, and the one thing that they would all have in common is the fact, and because she spends time with the Felicis, that is her first real exposure to Catholicism. They are very devout. They actually have a small chapel on their estate. And that's really her first brush, and I don't say that comedically at all, or her first exposure to the Eucharist. Now, interestingly enough, what happened to the American Anglican Church was very fascinating, because it was no longer the American Anglican after the Revolutionary War, because anything Anglo was reviled because of the war. And so what begins to take shape is the American Episcopal Church that we understand today. And part of the doctrine change that happened at that particular point of time, they were redesigning their Book of Prayers. And initially, from the tradition from England, they recognized the real presence. The American hierarchy for the Anglican Church denied it. It was just symbol. Now, interestingly enough, in the research, it said, had they not redefined that, Elizabeth would probably have remained within the Anglican community and had this devotion, because the Felicis really were very devout, and it was really her first exposure. The other thing, Catholics in the room, take note. There is a display in the back of the room of Knight of Columbus JFK. All right. If you're watching, because it's an election year, I'll just throw this in. One of the things that we as today, American Catholics in 2016, we have very little flavor for the discrimination that was experienced, such as the founding of the KFC to kind of combat that, if you will. All right. And that's only in the latter part of the 19th century. But my wife was watching PBS and they're doing the presidential years. And about 2 weeks ago, they did the Kennedy-Nixon, 1960. And I was stunned, because a Protestant as enlightened as Norman Vincent Peale goes on record and publishes a letter reviling the thought of an American Catholic being president. Keep in mind, JFK will go to Dallas, the same place of his death, 3 years later, and he will do that famous quote. He said, I want you, I want to leave here. By the way, my wife said, he's introduced. Silence. This is the American Baptist, or the Southern Baptist Conference. He gets up, gives a very eloquent speech, and he closes, or somewhere in there, he says, I want you to understand one thing. I am an American Catholic before I am a Catholic American. The speech closes and they give him a 2 minute standing ovation. So we have to see it through their world. There was a high level of discrimination. If you chose to be Catholic, which Elizabeth does, immediately after her conversion, she is shunned by all. She had been running a girls' school in New York City. And the minute that the local community, William is dead, she had returned to the country, she's kind of dabbling, she enters the church, She is converted. And the minute that word gets out, everyone leaves her, including her family. Just total disownment. The only two that hang on, and I, again, because I'm just doing the highlights, were her two sister-in-laws, Harriet and Cecilia. They will go on to actually become charter members of her new community. But the atmosphere in New York City was so hostile that at the bequest of John Carroll of Baltimore, she moves there, establishes a school, and then also under his auspices, he's a Jesuit, founder of Georgetown University. With the Sulpician fathers, they moved roughly 40 miles to the west to what is now Emmitsburg, Mount St. Mary College, and she, in fact, is buried there. All right? And so what you have is the price that was paid. All of these paid a price. Isaac Jogues paid the price of coming here. Kateri was totally shunned once she became a Christian. Likewise, Mother Seton, it cost her. And Mother Cabrini had to fight tooth and nail. Now, it's interesting because I was in the Papal Gallery. It's always fascinated me, if you get a chance to walk around, Pope Leo XIII, he was in the presence in having audiences with four saints. One, the little flower. She wanted to enter Carmel at a young age. And they said, she says to him, she says, if you say so, they'll do it, Your Holiness, all right, for permission. The next one, but we'll get to it in a minute, is Catherine Drexel. Catherine Drexel is an heiress from Philadelphia. I'm going to give a handout in a minute. And she is toying with this idea. And she comes into the presence. And then you have Mother Cabrini, who has really is kind of almost the Mother Teresa of her time. Again, you know, kind of throwing in for interesting information. If you remember the Merv Griffith show from like the 1970s, all right, there was a very raucous gal would come on. She was almost like a Dorothy Parker. And her name was Elda Rogers St. John. And she was a buck reporter, a cub reporter in the early 19th century. And she's sitting there with Merv. She might have been smoking a cigarette, kind of Katharine Hepburn with the slacks, short hair. And she, oh yeah, I interviewed her. And I'm like, hello, let me listen to this. She said, let me tell you, she said she was really something. And by that time, the buzz of Mother Teresa had been out, like the late 70s, so everybody was aware now. And she said she was very much in the profile of this Mother Teresa of Calcutta. And she said, but you know the most interesting thing that ever happened to me when I went? She said, I interviewed, she was in California. Mother Cabrini traveled everywhere. She had, as a child, she had fallen in a canal. She almost drowned, and because of that, her fear of water was something she could not overcome, and yet she made over nearly 30 transatlantic voyages around the Horn, I mean the whole thing, being totally in a state of fright and fear. Okay, so anyway, back to the cub reporter, who's now, at that point, she was probably in her 80s, God bless her. And she said, but you know what? She said, I was leaving the convent that day. And she was very low key, and she, you know, she said goodbye to her. And she said, I was walking out, and one little gal, sister goes, she said, she won't tell you this. And of course, being a reporter, I'm all ears. And she said, well, she said, this happened about a month and a half ago. She said, one of our sisters was almost dying with a fever, and we thought we were going to lose her. And she said, we went to Mother, who wanted to be kept posted, etc. And she said, Mother took off her stockings and gave them to me, and I gave them to the sister, and within 24 hours, she was healed. So, your reporter's saying this on the Merv Griffith show. Everybody's in the audience of this. She said, and of course, you know, being a reporter, she said, go figure, all right? But again, holiness kind of radiates. And Mother Cabrini was very much that. It's very interesting, the parallel between Mother Cabrini and Mother Seton. As we know, she's going to be canonized in September. Her famous phrase is, she received a call within a call. She was on the train, Mother Teresa, and she looks out at the poverty of India, and she is already a professed religious sister. The same thing happened to Mother Cabrini. She's probably about this big, very, very frail, but it was like, get up and go. As a matter of fact, when Pius XII canonizes her in July of 1946, he, you know, from a fairly sexist point of view, to think that this little tiny woman, in spite of all these odds, could go on to the, you know, altars of glory, etc., etc. And this is a woman who never took no for an answer. Very much like Mother Teresa. If you remember, Mother Teresa got a lot of flack because they were questioning who was giving her money. And she said, I don't care who gives me money. They'll talk to God. She said, I just have to talk to and take care of the poor. And that was very much Mother Cabrini's also. She always had the hat out. But the other thing is she arrives, again, more threads. She arrives in March of 1889. And Archbishop Corrigan has sent for her, but then it kind of changed his mind. So she's like this on the porch with him, saying, what do you mean we're going back? We're not going back. So she takes herself down to the then ghetto, the Italian neighborhood. It is so filthy that the sisters would not even lay in the bed. So they spent their entire night in prayer around the dining room table. And the next day, there's a knock on the door, and guess who shows up? The Sisters of Charity. So she would say to Mother Seton, if it wasn't for your daughters, we would have had no place to stay for the extended, to begin our community in New York City. So those are the kind of threads. As a matter of fact, Mother Cabrini's name is actually on the base of the Statue of Liberty. There's a tie into that. So all of them, as they would sit, all right, she lives until 24. She lives until she's 47. 67. She lives until the early 40s, and he dies at roughly 39 or 40 years of age, all right? But they all, in their own way, put a very, very particular mark on the church in America. Very different, because part of the wonder of them is they were all looking in the same direction. So when I went to the college library, the Good Dominican Sisters, if you want to become a saint, this is how much they're going to write about you. Now watch. This was originally published in 1884 as they were beginning the process of the investigation of Isaac Jogues and Kateri Tekakwitha. And so this is what the postulator or the promoter of the cause would submit to Rome. This is published in English, and this is actually published in 1940. All right. They no longer, by the way, in the process of canonization, use the term devil's advocate. That's no longer on the screen. And it's only one miracle, and then, you know, this is, you're on your way. But this is fascinating as far as the documents that they would, you know, figure out, because they want to promote. The key word is not just a good person. The key word is heroic, meaning, for example, you look at the authors of America, and one of the authors that I respect, I don't agree with her all the time, was Lillian Hellman. And Lillian Hellman, during the Red Scare of, or the Red Hunt of the 1940s and early 50s, she has a famous line. And the line is, when she was called before the House on Un-American Activities, she said, I have no intention of adjusting the hemline of my morality to meet the fashion of the day. All right? So what she does is these people stood their ground. You can kind of look on with each other. I'll see if I have enough. Oh, thank you. Good. Let me just take one here. Good. And these, you can Google this. These are actually a list of the beatified and the pending. So I've highlighted them, and we can go through in terms of men and women who are still in the process of having their cause investigated, along with, this wasn't a plant, all right, our host saint, Father McGivney, all right? So he is technically a venerable. And venerable moves on from servant of God. So I highlighted our four, all right, Isaac Jogues, Francis Cabrini, and Elizabeth Ann Seton. And then on the other page, that's where Catherine Drexel of Philadelphia. She is an heiress. And one of the things that she does is, she's Catholic, her parents die, and they leave her and her brothers and sisters, Drexel University in Pittsburgh, Philadelphia, is her family. And they leave her enough fortune that, listen to this, in her lifetime, she lives until the 1950s, she's 90-something when she passes away, she creates just the interest alone that she can begin her order, which serves the African American and Native American peoples of the United States, $12 million put to that work, all right? And then, of course, we have Kateri. Now, you read a book, you learn. At the bottom, you'll see Blessed Mother Teresa of Calcutta. Notice the footnote, was declared an honorary citizen of the United States in 1996 by vote of Congress. So technically, she's going to be one of ours also, which is kind of fascinating also. And let's go to the venerables, all right? If you want to be dazzled, and if you want to scratch your head as far as courage, Google Cornelia Connolly. Let me fill you in very quickly. She was a Protestant. She marries a man by the name of Pierce Connolly, and he goes through this traumatic, I don't know what I want to be. He is ordained an Episcopal priest, not a problem, and they have children, and then all of a sudden he gets it in his head, that he wants to be a Catholic priest, in spite of the marriage. And the church at that point, unlike today, so if an Anglican comes into the Roman Catholic community, as you know, they may maintain their marriage and their family life. At that point, it was not. She then was forced to take a vow of virginity and enter a convent with her children. All because he wanted this conversion experience. Come to find out, if you're from the metropolitan area, years ago, I was sharing with my friend the other day on the phone, years ago there was a theater group in New York City called the Black Friars Theater. And they would present lives of the saints. And one of the programs I saw when I was probably 13 or 14 years old was the trial called Connolly versus Connolly, where she's living in England and he has left the church, completely bugged out as far as any religious formation, becomes virulently anti-Catholic, and sues her in British court to draw her out of the convent and make her come home to him. Because according to British law, children and spouses were property of the man. He lost the case. She is now a venerable. So if I'm telling you, talk about heaven being a mixed situation of what people have struggled through, it is just an eye-opener. Solanus Casey. Solanus Casey is a Capuchin, and he was a simple man, so simple that his order, the Capuchins, did not give him full rites. He could say Mass, but he could not hear confession. God's got a sense of humor. What happens is the Lord gives him the gift of discernment. So he was a reader of spirit. So if you came in the door, he could tell you chapter and verse exactly what your problem was on a spiritual basis. All right? And also, he was the porter at the door. Now, if you're familiar in terms of contemporary Catholic personality in the New York area, Father Benedict Rochelle established a new order. All right, the Friars of Renewal. And so he and a group of men, under correct guidance, left the Capuchins. But he would also share the fact that when he was a seminarian, he knew Solanus Casey. Very simple guy. If you see him, he's got kind of like a bald head, you know, Smith Brothers beard, etc. But again, very gentle man, and denied confession, but can read spirit. In terms of, I'm going to tell you, I can't forgive you your sins, but after you and I talk, you're going to go to confession, you're going to feel a lot better. All right? Now, interestingly enough, obviously, in terms of Father McGivney, our host. Now, Venerable Henrietta, this is interesting, don't gasp. About 8 years ago, there was a made-for-TV movie, and the woman who portrayed her was Vanessa Williams. Because Henrietta was a mulatto in the circle of New Orleans society, and it was very socially acceptable for mulatto attractive women to be courtesaned out to wealthy white planters and, you know, men with money. And her mother wanted to do that to her, and she tried, and Henrietta fought it. And then the mother, as a matter of fact, the mother in the movie, it's called A Time for Love. So Google that. It's a fascinating story. The actress who portrays the mother, who can't understand the daughter, you know, denying herself this access to, you know, accessibility, was Diane Carroll. All right. Again, very light-skinned, etc., moving in the circles. All right. So she has a fantastic story. Okay. Fulton J. Sheen, pending scent, an Emmy winner. All right, also cover of Time Magazine, 1950. He had the number one show, Life is Worth Living. All right, it's kind of in reruns. Pierre Toussaint. Pierre Toussaint is an African-American man of color and a worker with the poor, but his occupation, as I said, mixed bag, he was a barber and a hairdresser, a maker of wigs in the early part of his life. He is actually, his remains have been transferred to the cathedral, and in St. Patrick he is. You go to the back of the main altar, if you're familiar, and there's all the steps down. Cardinal Cook is there. We'll get to him in a second. Sheen is there, Pierre Toussaint is there, all of the cardinals. If you're familiar with the Catholic tradition, if you visit the cathedral and you look up, you'll see the hat of the cardinal, the very medieval with the tassel, very much like this lamp. And it's put up there when he dies, and it remains until it just rots and then it falls. So I think right now there might be three there now, because Cardinal Egan just only died recently, so that's kind of bright red. All right, so be aware of that in the cathedrals as you go in. It's kind of an honor to them. And so as I said, this is also being promoted very much. Last but not least, low rank on the process, we'll go to the back. Servants of God, that's us. That's what everybody is. And the reason why we know that is when Pope Francis signs his letters, he said, I am the servant of the servants of God. So just by our baptism, we get to be here, technically. Now, obviously, you have to afford the whole process, all right? And you have to have, first, what is formed is a guild. Now, the interesting thing as far as canonization, for example, she's only canonized several years ago. Interestingly enough, she is canonized Italian by Pius XII, the very year after the end of the Second World War. And to a certain degree, Pius XII was honoring the intervention of Americans in the Second World War by canonizing her. Keep in mind, she became a citizen in Seattle in 1909. My mother was also naturalized, okay? So she loved America. One time, my son's a bowler, and we went to the bowling capital of the world, which is Reno, Nevada. Don't ask, all right? The smallest, biggest little city in the world. But anyway, I went to the cathedral, which is not much bigger than this, but it works for them. And I look up, and who's getting off a train in a stained glass window on the platform? Mother Cabrini. She stopped in Reno. Whether she played the wheel, I don't know. All right, she always wanted money, go figure. All right, but anyhow, just the breadth of her travel. So she's sworn in as a naturalized citizen. So she technically is the first American. She is then beatified by John the 23rd, roughly 2 months before he dies in 1963. It's also the same year, tragically, that JFK will perish. All right, and then she's canonized in linking, if you will, to the American bicentennial. By the way, this year, the United States will be 220 years old. So can you believe, where did all that time go when we were all putting on tricorn hats in 1976 and whooping it up, all right? And then Kateri, as I said, she was only canonized about maybe 2 years ago, all right? All right, let's consider. Terence Cardinal Cook. He has a promoter. He was cardinal roughly in the 70s, all right? He was the heir apparent to Francis Cardinal Spellman. And he is being promoted. Dorothy Day, so if you're familiar with the Catholic Worker, watch. Cardinal Dolan is very hot for her cause, as is Pope Francis, we hear, with his identity with the poor. All right, they will all share the joy of telling Isaac Jogues that if it wasn't for the Jesuits, I wouldn't be here. Kateri was missionized by them. She is given confirmation by John Carroll. All right, the only bishop in the United States. He comes, visits New York, lays hands on her as a Jesuit. And then last but not least, they had a piece of property, which still exists today, and it is just north of Poughkeepsie on the west side, just south of Kingston, near Highland or East Opus, and it's called Cabrini Home. Initially, it's still an orphanage or school for children. Initially, she was buried there. When they exhume her, they move her down to one of her many institutions. Her body is actually under the main oil in what used to be the Cabrini Academy, because her vocation is very much with education, all right? But Dorothy Day, watch her. I met her. Shake the hand. There was a farm, it was called Catholic Worker, and it's in Columbia County, just north of Dutchess, where I live. And it was called the Catholic Worker Farm. She has a major conversion experience. She was living in common law with a gentleman, had a child. The child, the daughter, only died about maybe 5 years ago. Dorothy right now has multiple grandchildren, probably about my age, okay? She links up with Peter Morin. And they begin basically the Catholic Worker movement, all right? And what she does, she was a socialist communist initially, roughly at the time of the First World War. She has this conversion experience, but what drew her into the faith is the fact that she knew Latin. And so when she would go to Mass, it was not a foreign tongue to her. So she was very much, you know, getting the vibe of what they were saying. And interestingly enough, John Carroll, as early as the American Church was at that point, he had already begun to petition Rome to make the Catholic experience in America less foreign, and wanted to appeal for a dispensation and have the Mass and the service in the vernacular of English. So again, it would not be another stigma against the Catholic population in terms of hocus pocus or whatever, all right? Keep in mind, virulent anti-Catholic material, virulent. One of the things I'll share kind of in closing is this, because I'm getting to my hometown girl down here. I grew up in Hawthorne, New York, named after Rose Hawthorne, all right? She was Nathaniel Hawthorne's daughter. She is married. They both have a conversion experience, she and her husband, and he is abusive to the nth degree. She files for an annulment. She then declares herself kind of celibate from him, and then she will go on to form the Dominican Order, which still runs Rosary Hospital in New York City and Rosary Hill Home in Hawthorne, New York, named after her. That was probably the first apostolate that I was ever involved with the Legion of Mary. We would go and visit the patients, and it still is there. Very touching. If you go to the chapel, and it's open to the visitors, her story is called Sorrow Built a Bridge. Dorothy Day's story, her autobiography, is called The Long Loneliness. But if you go into the chapel at Rosary Hill and Our Lady of Grace, her hands are out, they put her wedding ring on the pinky of the statue. And they are also promoting her cause. But anyway, Catholic discrimination on a personal basis, and I'll close with this and then we maybe can do some Q&A. When I was growing up, I was very fortunate. My father was a very, very successful entrepreneur, had established his own business, an oil business. And he had mentored a young man that was the salesman for, at that time, Esso, which is now Exxon. And his name was Bob. And so Bob and my father were very close, you know, kind of this mentor situation. And one night my dad came home. This was probably 1959, prior to Kennedy. He came home and he was not himself. And so my mother and I were sitting at the table. He said, you don't seem yourself. And we had met Bob and his wife, lovely young couple. And he said, I'm not. And I said, well, what do you need? Now, my father took guff off of nobody. Son of Irish immigrants, didn't finish high school, Horatio Alger to the max, up by your own bootstraps, nobody gave me anything, blah, 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 all right? Very devout, and then I'll share the reason in a minute. But anyhow, so we're talking, and he said, well, I'm upset about Bob. I said, because I knew him, met him, and I said, why are you upset? And he said, because he's going into management in Esso. And I said, what's the problem with that? He said, he'll go nowhere because he's Catholic. Now, I'm 15 years old, have lived in the village all my life with Italians and Irish. You know, we tolerate the Lutherans. I mean, basically, it was it's the truth. I mean, Wayne Buckwell was my best friend. I mean, he went to that church. But anyway, and I'm looking at him like he has six heads. He said, you have no idea in terms of older generation talking to younger generation. I said, you're kidding. He said, no, I'm not. No, I'm not. He said, why do you think I started my own business? He said, they wanted to hire me. He said, I wasn't having it. He said, I was going to make my own life and have nobody define me. All right. Then one of the things you talk about our evangelical brothers and sisters tithing. My father was a great tither, but for dubious reasons, and he's laughing in heaven right now. I said, you know, you're very generous to the church. And he said, well, I'd rather give it to the church than those blankety blanks in Washington, because they're just going to not know what to do with my money. All right. So again, being near April 15th, it kind of plugs in. All right. But because of that, in terms of tithing and being blessed, my family was always very, very blessed. But Rose Hawthorne, Isaac Hecker, anybody know what he did? Go. Paulus Mann. You got it. All right. He, one of my favorite shows during the 60s was Insight, where they were a Hollywood production company. The Paulists would run it, and they would do these morality plays, and they were fantastic. And the gentleman, the MC, very Dave Garraway looking, very, you know, smart looking, etc. And he really, their main church is right off Columbus Circle down in Manhattan, so they're promoting his cause also. So anyway, bottom line of the lecture, three words: don't give up. See you in heaven. Good. Hope you enjoyed it. Any questions? Any information? I'm looking at the watch and I'm right on time. So this is a good thing. Yes.
How did your dad's friend Bob make out?
I don't know. Don't know. It, you know, but they remained friends. But then, as I said, everything turned around with Kennedy. Now, it's not that it wasn't there. You have to understand, Kennedy's own father had experienced, you know, discrimination up at Harvard, etc. So, you know, Irish is long on memory, short on forgiveness. That's Irish Alzheimer's. I'm Irish. That's Irish. You forget everything but the grudge, you know, as far as just the way that it is, all right? And it just hung on and hung on and hung on. Anything else? Yes.
Thoroughly enjoyed your presentation.
Well, thank you.
You have an incredible mind, and I'm glad you made this.
what's there left of it? Continue.
With the relationship you mentioned about the Mohawks, how would things improve, or how or when?
Well, you have to realize, and again, from the Catholic perspective, when she was canonized, there was a huge representation that were not pleased. Remember, X amount of years ago, you know, in terms of 1992, within the Native, and I can't speak to that because it's not part of my heritage, you know, everybody is not pleased with the Columbian experience. And what you have to realize is there was a tremendous upcry when reservations and all of that, when they took the tribal people, the indigenous people, and kind of put them through this cookie cutter American experience. So not everybody was pleased upon her canonization as being a product of Western Christian evangelization.
But was there a period when the Mohawks stopped the killing?
Well, not really, because, you know, their religious structure, first of all, very pantheistic. The interesting thing, when you look at the conversion experience of, say, Mexico, all right, when you look at the Aztecs, I mean, talk about a rough crowd, all right, every day somebody's going to be sacrificed, you know, with the heart and the beating so the sun can come up. And I'm saying this is a put down, but watch what? When the missionaries come to the Aztecs, they got on board evangelically. Say, you know what? We believe that somebody died for us to save us too. Only we call him Jesus. And he shed his blood just like the person being sacrificed. He was sacrificed only on a cross. We got you. Because remember, all right, it was Pope Gregory the Great. I teach communications and I give this to my students. Pope Gregory the Great, as a matter of fact, I heard it on an evangelical station. Three things for effective communication: the knowledge of the spirit of the speaker, the openness of the learner or listener, and the language used. So you can yakada yakada yakka. And one of the things I always share with my students is, you know, the doctor at the front of the room is brilliant, but you're learning nothing because he or she can't get it to the message that you understand it. And that's really the power of effective evangelization. Let's talk about Pope Francis, all right? There was a poster many years ago, and it just makes me laugh even this day. Big poster, and it says, if you have the joy of the Lord in your heart, please notify your face. And that's what everybody is talking about. I mean, he doesn't have to say a thing. You know, what makes you happy? Let me tell you. Because you're either living it. Remember, a late friend of ours, he was a priest, and I heard him speak one day. He said, you have to realize from church history, he said, for the first 300 years, our faith was a faith of attraction, not promotion. See how these Christians love one another. Why the heck is he dying in the arena? Look at all those lions. What does he see that I don't? That's still the new evangelization. Why are you so happy and peaceful? Fill me in. No, he filled me up. And when you see saints like this, that's it. I mean, you know, you're drawn to people who get it done for all the right reasons. If that answers your question. Anybody else? Yes.
We were up in Upper New York State near Albany.
Yes.
And there was this church that we visited, and it was made out of wood.
That's Orrisville. That's the Shrine of the North American Martyrs.
Okay.
That's where Kateri, I keep going back and forth because I was raised on Kateri. Actually, I was raised on Catherine. That's where the original mission was. It's west of Albany, and that's where Isaac Jogues died, and that's where Kateri is born. She, because it becomes hostile, she and a whole group of Christian Indians move north to Canada.
That was a beautiful place.
It's stunning. It's a huge pilgrim. In the fall, oh, color to the max. It's unbelievable. Absolutely gorgeous. And you know what? Literally, when you talk about Moses and the burning bush, you know, take off your shoes, you're on holy ground, you feel it immediately.
Yeah, no, you do. Yeah.
You really do. It's wonderful. Anybody else? Okay, Ita Misa Estra, whatever, I want to close this. All right, thank you again. Hope you enjoyed it.